Okay. All right, guys. So we're moving on. This time we're going to start talking about what makes arguments good and bad. Okay. So far, all we've really talked about what arguments are, right? They're a collection of statements, some of which provide support for others, right? Like there's premises that support a conclusion, and that's what an argument is. So today we're going to start talking about how to tell if arguments are good ones or bad ones, right? And importantly, this is going to have a lot more to do with the form of an argument than its actual content, okay? Its content is going to come in at the very end, but mostly today we're going to talk about how to evaluate the form of an argument. So I'll show you what I mean by that as we move through two sort of central concepts in critical thinking, and especially critical thinking about arguments, and that's validity and soundness. Okay, so we can just get the old PowerPoint fired up here. That's what we're going to talk about today. So what makes an argument good rather than bad? Okay, and the two things you got to know: a good argument is valid and a good argument is sound. And we're going to talk about those two things and what they mean, right? So what's validity? Let's start there. That's the more important one. In a valid argument, if the premises are true, then the conclusion is necessarily true. Another way to say that, in a valid argument, if the premises were true, if you may assume that they're true, give the arguer the benefit of the doubt, say, I don't know if these are facts or not, but he's saying they are, so if he says they're true, we'll assume they're true, right? Then his conclusion logically follows from those premises. In other words, it has to be true. Right? There's no world in which it could be the case that it could be false. All right. So I know this is weird. It takes a little while to get your head around it, but we'll sort of walk through it. So notice this is about form, not content. The if here is key. Right? It's if the premises were true. It's not saying the premises have to be true. This is about the form of the argument and the way that the premises are related to the conclusion. It's not about whether or not the premises are actually true. I can't say that one enough. Right? Here's an example. Here is one premise. If it rained last night, then there will be a puddle outside my door. That's one premise. Right? Premise two, it rained last night. Number three, therefore, there will be a puddle outside my door. Okay? So, look, it doesn't actually matter if it rained last night or not, right? It doesn't matter if number two is true or not, and it doesn't matter if number one is true or not. But, like, it doesn't matter if rain actually puddles outside my door when it rains, you know? The point is, let's assume that those things are true. If we assume that those two are true, right, then this has to be true. There's no world where this could be false. And that's, my friends, a valid argument, okay? So where if the premises are true, then the conclusion has to be true, all right? So this one actually follows a pretty, you know, common form of valid argumentation. It's called modus ponens, okay? So you can always just sort of look and see, like, is this what's going on here? Modus ponens, or affirming the antecedent, is also what it's called. And we're going to talk about all kinds of various forms of arguments in a different lecture, okay? But I'm just sort of noticing, like, that's what this is. And so that's a valid form of argumentation, right? Because, so, you know, it's sort of like word math, right? It doesn't really matter what's here. What takes the place of the variables, right? We just know, like, if we see this form, right, that is a valid form, right? So if it rained last night, that's their P, then there will be puddle outside my door. That's your Q. So here's P, right? Here's Q. Right, and then here we got Q again. So therefore P. See, there is no universe where if this were true and this were true, that this wouldn't be true. It's just logically has to be that. Hope that makes sense. It takes a little while to get your head around these things. So if you have questions, email me or whatever, right? But don't worry, we're going to go through some more stuff to try and sort of and the South. All right, so notice again, validity, not about truth content. You can have valid arguments with false premises. So here's one. If the sun rises in the east, then the earth is flat. The sun rises in the east, therefore the earth is flat, okay? Look, this is bull malarkey, right? It's not true that if the sun rises in the east, then the earth is flat. But notice, it's a valid argument because we've got this form, right? Where if P, then Q, P, therefore Q. We've got the same thing going on here. So this is a valid argument because if it were true that if the sun rises in the east, then the earth is flat, right? Then, and it were true that the sun rises in the east, then it would have to be true that the earth is flat, okay? So it's a valid argument, even though it's complete garbage, right? So this is what we would call valid, but not sound, okay? A sound argument is one where it's valid and the premises are true, okay? So the valid and sound makes a good argument, but just valid, you don't need to have true premises, all right? So how to test for invalidity informally. This is a critical thinking class. It's not a formal logic class, so we're only really going to talk about how to do this kind of informally, right? All you have to do is ask yourself, can I imagine a world where the premises of this argument are true and the conclusion is false? Could that happen, right? And if the answer is yes, you got yourself an invalid argument. If the answer is no, you got yourself a valid argument, okay? So let's take a look here. Wally has 10 fingers and 10 toes, so Wally is a human. This is a very simple argument. We got one premise here. That's number one. That's your premise. This right here is your conclusion from one. It's a terrible argument, right? Because Wally has 10 fingers and 10 toes, so Wally is a human. Is this valid? No, of course not, because you can imagine a world where Wally's a dog and she has 10 fingers and 10 toes, right? Like, there's a million... You can imagine a world where Wally has 10 fingers and 10 toes and is not a human, okay? So it can't possibly be valid. So it's an invalid argument, right? Here's one. Frank is the president of the United States, so Frank must have been elected by the people, okay? Well, let's think about this. Is there a world in which there could be a president of the United States that was not elected by the people? Yes, right? Frank could have been the vice president of the United States, and then the president dies, and then he becomes the president, right? That's totally possible, right? So it's happened more than once in American history, right? So this is an invalid argument because there is a world in which the premise is true and the conclusion is false. Does that make sense? I hope it does, okay? Here's another one. Let's try this one. A person can only be president of the United States if they are born in Kenya. Frank is the president of the United States, so Frank was born in Kenya. Now, notice, not true. Okay, also, not true. Frank is not the president of the United States. I don't know who Frank is, but he's certainly not the president. Okay, so can you imagine a world, though, where it is true that you could only be president if you were born in Kenya, and Frank is the president of the United States, but Frank was not born in Kenya? No, you can't. So it's a valid argument, okay? Does that make sense? That's how you test for validity. Can you imagine a world where the premises are true and the conclusion is false? And if the answer is yes, it's an invalid argument. The answer is no, it's a valid argument. This stuff is tricky, I know. It takes a while to wrap your head around. So I'm gonna say it like 17 more times before this is over. And yeah, we'll see. All right, so this is now just sort of like another thing that we've got to cover about missing premises, okay? So critical thinking and learning these kinds of tricks, like they can kind of turn you into a jerk sometimes, right? You know, you get so tuned into these like sort of, oh, that's an invalid argument. And you can be kind of a dick when someone's just trying to make a point, right? And so I think it's important just to notice, right, that when you're dealing with a text or with an argument that somebody's giving you, you always want to sort of practice the principle of charity, all right? You always want to give your argument the benefit of the doubt, you know, sort of like engage with its best possible form. So, you know, when you're evaluating an argument, you know, help out your interlocutor, maybe, right? So sometimes people put forward invalid arguments just because they forget to include an obvious premise, right? Something that we just take to be true, right? So what you got to do is kind of like lend your interlocutor, lend the person who's arguing here a kind of a hand and try to give them the premises that you know that they're relying on, but they don't say explicitly. Right? That's just a better thing to do, and it turns into less of a jerk, right? So don't, in other words, just don't be cheap, right? Like if you want to, test your beliefs and figure out if something's worth believing, like don't just discount somebody because they make an invalid argument because they don't use a premise that is pretty obvious, okay? So for instance, Wally has 10 fingers and 10 toes, so Wally's a human. As we said before, this isn't a terrible argument, right? So how could we make it better? Well, she's missing a premise. Only humans have 10 fingers and 10 toes, right? So Wally has 10 fingers and 10 toes. Only humans have 10 fingers and 10 toes. If you take this premise, right, that the author is kind of just assuming we all know, then we've got ourselves a valid argument, don't we? But it's not sound because it's just not true that only humans have 10 fingers and 10 toes, okay? So, you want to give them the missing premise, right, and then engage with that version of the argument, right? And then it still turns out that it's a terrible argument. Okay, fine. Here's one. All Canadians love hockey, so Steve loves hockey. Okay, what's the missing premise here? Think about it for 10 seconds. Missing premise, Steve is a Canadian. Okay, so notice, without the missing premise, it's not valid, right? Is there a universe in which all Canadians love hockey and Steve also loves hockey? Sure. You know, Steve could be American. Steve could be Dutch. Steve could be from, I don't know, Reagan. Outer space, okay? But the author's kind of assuming that we know that Steve is a Canadian here. Otherwise, why would he make that argument, right? So you got to sort of extend him the principle of charity and assume the missing premise. So then you've got a valid argument, but again, it's not sound because not all Canadians love hockey. I know a couple. Anyway. All right, how about this one? The temperature of the water is 212 degrees Fahrenheit, so the water is boiling. What's the missing premise? Water boils at 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Like the author's just assuming that we know that, right? So extend him. So without it, it's an invalid argument, but like he's just assuming that we would know that. So extend him the benefit of the doubt, practice the principle of charity, right? And so then this one would be a valid and sound argument. It's a good argument. Okay. That's it for this lecture, all right? This one is hard, so I really think you should take a look at the textbook this week and especially look at the exercises, okay? Work through them before you take the TEIC quizzes, right? So you can practice a bit and try to figure out what inductive argument is and a deductive argument is, what a valid argument looks like versus an invalid argument, okay? This one just takes a little while to get your head wrapped around, so just spend a bit of time thinking about it. Okay, I hope this helps. If you have questions, you can always email me. Okay, bye-bye.